here. We're now live with Joe Schipani. Is that how you say your last?
Schipani.
Okay, yeah. And so you're the director of Flint Public Art Program. How long has that program been
going? Flint Public Art Project has been around since 2012. It started off as a project, our program under Amplifier Inc., and then grew into its own organization.
Okay. Cool. So, 2012, and did you get the idea for Flint Public Art Project from what maybe Detroit was doing?
I did not. So, Flint Public Art Project started from Stephen Sachs, which is our old executive director, that grew up in Flint, lived there until he was about 10 or 12 years old, moved to New York, came back to Flint, started the project under his New York nonprofit, Amplifier Inc., started some other programming. I got involved in about 2013 and became a board member and started working with them about 2013. And then 2015, I became the executive director.
Okay, cool. So I know that you guys have, so right now we're here with Joe Schipani and also Matt from PixelStix, and what PixelStix is a technology piece for mural mapping, and I know you guys have one of the biggest PixelStix collections.
Yes.
In terms of mural mapping, so in what way do you kind of see that technology helping your community or building your community in Flint?
Well, it helps ours because we're able to track map. I mean, a few things. To help the community, one of the things that will help the community is it's giving neighborhoods and other organizations, we're going to be able to start collecting data off of the murals to be able to share with neighborhoods, with businesses, so we can tell them, hey, these are X amount of people that have been going to your business or been by your business looking at a mural.
Right.
And these are the times and days that they're coming by there that, you know, we notice that you close at 6 o'clock and most people come at 6:30. Maybe you might want to stay open another hour, you know, and try it out on this day or whatever. With the neighborhoods, what it does is it shows traction, and we're working on getting the crime data in the area and comparing the crime data before and after the mural is installed to the traction from the mural. So we have a direct kind of correlation of whether or not if the crime went down, is the mural part of that? You know, stuff like that. But it also gives them data of how many people are in their neighborhood, doing stuff in their neighborhood, and it can help them with grants and help them grow.
Right. Yeah, I feel like that's the part of the conversation that that I'm super interested in terms of public art and community and engagement, or how that art can be, because we're all part of these small communities, you know, like whether we're part of a small community in our own house and we can barely get along, or we're part of a community in our neighborhood and neighbors barely get along, or we are part of, you know, a city community and all this.
Yeah.
Like, we're part of all these smaller communities, and how does art and outdoor art really play into connecting that community? I feel like Flint's a really good, just from the outside, I haven't been there, but I've seen what, like, Murals in the Market has kind of done with Detroit. I've seen some other programs, you know, that are sort of like that. And what Flint seems to be doing that's different is a lot of these programs come in, and you're talking about like gentrification in terms of like bringing outside artists in. All this money goes towards these outside artists, where it seems like Flint's a little more engaged on the street level with the artists that are in Flint. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like in the community, paired with other artists. I mean, would that be sort of accurate the way your program works? I know you bring other outside artists in, but
we also,
how does that conversation revolve around like the gentrification, you know, where people aren't screaming, oh, this art is gentrifying, but like how are people in the community engaged in that conversation?
Well, and I also think the reason we started doing the murals is through community engagement. And so there has been a lot of things that's happened in Flint The water crisis, the Netflix, all these other organizations capitalizing on the blight and destruction of Flint. And one of the things with Netflix, when that Flint town came out, a lot of the neighbors were talking and communities were talking, every time they went through a good neighborhood, they blurred things out. And so it was like they wanted to show that narrative of blight and destruction. And when they went through stuff that was good, they blurred it out. And then they, so one of the, you know, and we have a lot of different neighborhood community groups that are doing so many great things in the neighborhoods that are amazing. They're building pocket parks, they're doing cleanups, they're doing all this great stuff. And so it's, how do we make people say, what is behind that blur? And lots of color behind these beautiful projects that people are doing are ways to say what's behind that blur. So that's kind of how that started. So after that, we got into, last year I think we did 17 neighborhood workshops with different neighbors and neighborhood groups, different community groups, schools, and had them discuss where would they want a mural, what would they want to see, who would they want to see paint it, and all these other stuff.
Oh, so did you give them a list of artists maybe to choose from? Or?
Yes.
Okay, that's cool.
So a lot of these workshops, it's like here are the artists that we can bring here. Here are our local artists. Who would you like to see? And then we kind of try to narrow it down. Some people got overwhelmed by looking through artists, and it's like, I don't know. Some people are like, okay, these are the people I like, you know, and so we try to pick it out that way.
As curators of this, like, do you guys sort of push that conversation forward with a suggestion, you know, so that it's not like a ton of cooks in the kitchen, or do you just kind of like...
Well, we've done a lot of workshops, so a lot of the workshops start off with that talk, and usually a lot of them have been like a word cloud kind of session. So the first session, it's like, okay, what would you like to see? And of course, everybody in the room has a different idea.
Yeah.
It's like, well, let's go with different words that describe this area, what it is that you want to reflect, and then kind of build like a word cloud out of it. Take the three standout most important ones and find out how the other words connect. And then have the artist sometimes build from there, or then find maybe it's a theme that they decided they want, and then it's like, okay, let's try to find an artist that does that. So, and I'm just gonna use flowers and butterflies just because it's easy.
Yeah.
So if they came up with they want flowers and butterflies, okay, here's a bunch of artists, their portfolio is pretty much all flowers and butterflies, and which ones do you like the best, you know? And that way, the artist still has that creative freedom to kind of build from it.
Yeah.
But the neighborhood also gets what they want and what they want to see. And that's the big thing, is giving them the choice of what they want to see and not just putting something up there.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I feel like there's that conversation that kind of happens both ways with a lot of these different initiatives. Yeah. So sometimes it's just, we have the directors and we're going to pick the artists, we got the buildings, whatever goes up is going to go up, and then there's that community engagement. I think that, you know, either way works for a community. It just depends on, like, you know, how to navigate that those conversations, like, on the back end. Whether you do it that the other way where you're saying, all right, this is curated, or these are the artists that are coming up, or we have these walls and they're just going to have color on it, then you should be prepared for conversations after that, because people are going to, you know, throw their input in their own communities. So another reason I wanted to speak with you regarding the Flint project is because I feel like Tampa has some things that could be done that could benefit from things you've already done. So, like, in terms of like what they would consider blight and things like that, I mean, I grew up in the Midwest, and I grew up around Gary, and I've been in Flint, and I've seen, you know, some of these cities where they were like steel towns, or they were production towns, and you know, a lot of the buildings are vacant. You know, I mean, Detroit's like that as well. So Tampa doesn't necessarily have those types of clusters of like vacant buildings and things like that, but we do have an opportunity for collaboration with maybe like property owners and real estate owners and things like that, where you could do a pop-up art show within a warehouse, and then you get artists communicating with realtors or with property owners, and then maybe that building becomes a studio. You know, maybe that building becomes a gallery because it's sitting there vacant. And I feel like there's a lot of opportunities for that, especially out past Ybor, and you know, there's this whole stretch of kind of warehouse district between Ybor and like 60 and Brandon. And all those areas are like really good for this. So we've had an art community in Tampa that artists have lived here and moved away since the 70s. It's never been like a cohesive art community. You know, it's just now kind of starting to happen because all these pockets of people doing things are starting to come together in their little circles. So it's not like St. Pete. You know, I don't know how connected your art scene is, but have you done projects like that with vacant properties and things like that in Flint? And how has that helped your community in terms of your arts community coming in?
Well, we've done our Free City Festival for many years. That was, so there's a space along the river, the Flint River, that used to be miles of GM factory. And in that section, we had one section of that, we did kind of like a Burning Man style festival there. And during that festival, I mean, we had a variety of artists. We had concerts going on, people selling pop-up, you know, pop-up market stuff, selling their artwork, different sculptures interactive, people painting, all kinds of, there was a variety, performance arts, all kinds of stuff. And during those times, you got that art community together. And that made it, so that starts those conversations. Another good way to do that is to, I like to have, so all the artists, when they come to Flint, they stay at my house. And so while they're there, I make usually, this year was different, it was a unique year, but they all stayed at my house, but I make like a community dinner. And because I always feel that conversations around the dinner table are what really builds relationships.
Oh, yeah.
And so invite the local artist, have people come over, hang out together, get to know, market, network. So, you know, we've had a couple local artists that have connected with other artists from all over the world that had planned to kind of more travel and move on to do some other stuff this year, which some of them are able to do and some aren't, but they've made these connections and made some really good friendships, connections, networks, and able to really build up off dinner tables. And, you know, Matthew was up this summer and we were discussing how many people have sat around that table and how much art has been discussed around or created around that table.
Right.
And so it's like you can feel that energy in there.
Yeah, and with some of these other programs that you've put on, for instance, like when you did the Burning Man Style Festival, was the community really engaged in those events and wanted more of that? Was it almost like, oh, when are we doing this again, or, you know, that type of thing?
They were, except for that everybody knew when it ended, it was ending, because that area was transformed into a park.
Oh, okay.
And so that was the last section, so that last year, it was like everybody knew it was ending because a week later it was getting excavated. So everybody knew it was ending. But we do neighborhood art parades. And so what that is, we partner with the Michigan State Police and Walmart, and we do like a little festival, almost barbecue, in four different neighborhoods every year. And Walmart brings food and barbecues or grills out. The state police bring activities to play with the kids in the neighborhood. And we do like, we get a marching band. We have some different crafts for people to do there. And we do like a little parade in each neighborhood. And then come back and have a celebration with the music and all that stuff. And the neighborhoods love that.
Yeah.
And every year it's, I wish we had the funding to do 20 of them, because we can only really do four, because I get a list of, are you coming to my neighborhood? Are you coming to my neighborhood? And it's really great. It's a fun experience.
Yeah, I feel like one of the things, like, since you're working with Matt and with PixelStix technology, like, you could also do tours and biking.
Yeah.
Like, biking tours and walking tours. Yeah. Do you guys already have that in place in Flint as well?
Yeah, and Katie Yellow, that runs the What's Up Downtown project for the city, she does a bunch of different bike tours and activations and stuff like that with a lot of the downtown murals.
Cool.
Yeah, and does a really good job telling the stories of the murals.
Nice. And then is there any way that, like, I'm really interested also in like the value of all these projects, because one of the main things, like the core of a lot of my work, is looking at the value of outdoor art, which is like a free thing that has come from a free culture. Like, if you look at Wynwood, it was really started with production walls, it started with graffiti artists, it started with free, you know, work being put up, and then obviously street art and the graffiti world sort of, like, you know, blended together with some, like, Shepard Fairey and Fail and, you know, some of the other artists that kind of bridge these gaps between these two worlds. And, you know, murals are obviously ancient, you know what I mean? Like, you look at the Sistine Chapel, you look at, like, all these, you know,
caves.
The mural, cave paintings. I mean, it's not a new thing, really.
Right.
But because of the internet, because of the, you know, now people are starting to see these big, either their production walls or their murals or whatever, you know, that goes up on them, it's such a, you know, magnetizing thing where people are just like, I want that in my neighborhood, or I want that in my community. So how do you work with the artist to have that value conversation and get these projects funded? I mean, are they funded through the city, or are they funded through the community? I mean, what's your fundraising model?
Our project is grant funded. Majority of grant funded. We do get a lot of private donations. Mm-hmm. We get a few corporate donations. It's a variety of different funding. We're a small nonprofit.
Yeah.
A lot of artists have volunteered some of their time. Depending on, you know, we have a very small budget. I mean, I would love to pay every artist what the value of the murals are, which, you know, some are $10,000-$20,000 value.
Yeah.
I just can't do that as a small nonprofit.
Right.
And all the great artists, I mean, I love every artist that's come through Flint, and all the ones that worked with us in Flint, they're all amazing people. So, I mean, it ends up, my cost is about $2,500 a mural, somewhere in that range. This year we were able to give small stipends to people that came in, but we supply all the paint, all the...
You're giving artists a place to stay, that thing. You're giving them meals
And one of the other things is, it's like, one of my... Polly just left, but Polly and Kevin, one of the things is when they put up a mural with me, they get a lot of attention. And then they get a lot of commission jobs.
Right, yeah.
So that's one of the good benefits for them.
I feel like that's one of the side conversations of, because Flint isn't a festival. Like, it's not that you're doing murals for a week long, and it's like 20 artists they're painting for a week. You guys are doing like hundreds of murals each year, all year. And that's one direction and aspect of what Art Up is a side organization of merch culture, and we have programming and work that we're doing all year long. But then there's also festival planning and other, you know, concentrated things. And there's value in all of that. But what you are doing is basically all year long, you're doing these smaller projects, like one artist at a time. As you get a grant, you're coming in, bring them in, and you're kind of building a community around that.
And usually this year we've done one or two at a time because of everything going on, but last year we normally had about four people staying in our house with us.
Right.
And then we usually have about five or six murals going up every week with local artists and visiting artists. So we had quite a bit. Last year we did 105 murals. This year we did 45. and our partners, I mean, Colabs, which is, they do a lot of production in they're a production company in LA, and they do it, they're really entangled with the arts and street arts, and they have brought us a lot of resources to help us out. Their connections with the artist, and
who's that? Who is that?
Colabs.
Okay.
Yeah, they're out of LA, and not only have they brought artists in for us, they've also brought our artists out. So it's, they've been really good. Cobra Paint, they've been a really great sponsor for us. So there's been a lot of those, you know, big connections. Even Nomad Clan has done, they're an art collective that does murals.
Yeah.
And they do, they've done a lot of reaching out, fundraising, doing a lot of great stuff for us. So there's so many of these outside organizations that after being in Flint, just fell in love with Flint and want to keep being there.
Cool, yeah. And so how has the mural, how has the outdoor art in Flint kind of helped bring awareness to, like, with the water crisis and where that's going? Has there been any kind of cross between,
between
those two, here's a positive thing happening. What's Flint's brand? What's it known for? It's known for this, this water crisis. Like, are you using any of the murals to help with that?
Yes. So one of the things is changing the conversation.
Yeah.
Trying to change that conversation from crisis to art.
Right.
And so when we first really started the big push on murals, which was 2018, and then in 2019, we had a lot of, almost everybody in the beginning of 19 were coming in at, what about the water? What about this? What about the crime? We saw Netflix. We saw that Netflix show. Is it as bad as that? Da, da, da. I didn't have that once this year.
Right. Yeah.
You know.
I mean, and how is that situation improving in terms of how you're building this awareness from this positive thing, which is art, around what is happening?
One step forward, two steps back.
Okay.
That's about how it. It's like here we are. We have all this positive energy coming last year, and I went to two conferences at the beginning of this year. And we're both like, wow, we've been seeing your murals. And it was like the first time I went somewhere that someone wasn't like, how's the water?
Right.
And it was like, this is great. And then here comes the pandemic.
Yeah.
And then now that water crisis is pulled back, because we're going to have residual problems from the water crisis. I don't want to say that there's not going to, people were poisoned.
Yeah.
And that, there's going to be long-term side effects and things going on from that.
Yeah.
And, I've lived in Flint all through it. And, I've lived in Flint for 15 years. And so I've lived through that too, And it's like, I don't want to take away from what people are going through. But then when the pandemic hit, it's like, okay, you got Flint that has been poisoned. And now there's this pandemic. And so it kind of bubbles back up, so
right.
It's a, like I said, one step forward, two steps back,
right.
But we
right.
keep,
But have you done any specific, mural projects to help, positively help that situation, or to speak on it?
In 2017, we did a series of water crisis murals. With the group In Decline came to Flint, and they did a series of murals. One was Leaders Over Leaders, spelt the two different ways.
Right, right.
The other was a Greetings from Flint postcard that represented the water crisis. They also did a lemonade stand to play it off of that. So they did three or four murals when they were here.
To kind of raise awareness, or basically say,
yes, raise awareness.
Like active artivism.
Yeah. And so last year they came back and just did beautification.
Yeah, so I think that, so there's kind of things to point to, you know, that are unique to Flint. But do you work with anyone from Detroit as well, like with any of the not necessarily the artists, but you know, do you kind of bounce ideas off of something like mural in the market, or kind of pay attention to what those curators do, or are you kind of in your own bubble in Flint and do things completely, you know, different?
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
So we have a few different organizations that we've worked with over the past that we bounce ideas off of, that not really mural related, but then there's mural artists that do put up things and do things in Detroit that we work with that have done work here.
Right.
That it's like, hey, you need this, you know, because we have a big supply of paint. We have a couple of the artists like, hey, I can't find this color anywhere. Do you guys have it there? And we, you know, we work things out, and they've come up here. We've had four or five Detroit artists come up this summer and do some murals. And
in terms of like the PixelStix technology that you have on each, do you map every single mural that you've painted?
So we have 155 in our gallery.
Right, and if people aren't really familiar with the PixelStix technology, like this allows people to view the content from anywhere. You don't really have to be in Flint to see the mural content.
And the great thing is, so ours is set up different than what's not Neo Shine. So what ours has a page right now that has a picture of the mural, in the artist bio, that tells about the artist. Also, any of the links to the artist. So, if you want to go check out their social media, or if you want to go to their art page store and purchase art from them,
Okay. There
are links on there to go do all that.
Yeah, I feel like that's a really good opportunity. So, using maybe PixelStix to attach like a Venmo or a Cash App to a mural where people can go and they can see this outdoor. You know, I mean, people are taking photos outside of these murals
right. All
day, and if there was a way for them to throw an artist a tip as they're using that for their backdrop, that they're using that for their photo, I mean, a lot of times, like, we'll see, like, Subaru come or something in Mercedes will use a photo of murals in the market, and they'll, like, blood law firm has to do this big, you know, lawsuit.
Right.
But, like, for smaller photographers, people that are using these backdrops all the time, it'd be really good to like unify the standardized conversation around like, well, how do you sort of, it's almost like, hey, what you want, songs from iTunes or something. You
right.
know? It's almost like that sort of community, because a lot of the artists are doing the work for, especially in the festival environment and in this environment where you have a minimal amount of money, like they're doing the work for not a lot. And they may get those commissions, you know, off of that work, but maybe there's a conversation that can be started about like tipping these artists somehow through this technology. And I think that's like, you know, almost like a notification or something. So, I mean, Matt, how do you think that might work?
Well, I mean, one of the things that we work on a lot is, you know, we take all of those intrinsically known benefits of what murals bring a community, like, you know, crime reduction, which we haven't gotten into, or increased property value, or, you know, just bringing localized foot traffic to boutiques and areas. We target bringing light onto those things and bringing quantitative data to make sure that benefit is not only just commonly known and the artists are paid whatever they're paid, but there's actual data that can represent those values, that you can bring those to the conversations to local government, to the local businesses, and you start to have this accountability and the sustainability to address exactly what you were talking about.
Right, yeah. I think that it's like a conversation that could be standardized within the industry between artists, between curators, and basically figure out a way to make that a standardized thing. Because it's like, Radiohead dropped an album that like was, hey, what you want for whatever, like back in.
And it can be done. It can easily be done, like for us, because all I would need is, if you have a Venmo or a PayPal,
yeah.
I just put a tip the artist bar on it and connect it,
right.
And they can do that. The question is, do they have it?
Yeah.
Some do, some don't. Some, you know.
Some don't even care. Some of them just just like
right, and some don't want right, some don't want to.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, you know, so it's all different, and, you know, and it's also what it's doing. What PixelStix is also doing is it's also helping show the value of what the mural is by offering the information of who the artist is.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I look at the art here and I've seen some, but the name's been bled down so I can't really see who it is. And then it's like, okay, I gotta take a picture of it, but I don't know how to credit the person and all this other stuff, but I'm gonna put it out there and someone's gonna notice and then they're gonna say something, you know, so it's like, it creates the value when you say, this is who, like when you're right here, you put a value on this price, on this piece of art. You said who it is, this is what it's worth, this is who did it. You can research who did it. When you're out on the street, on any mural, you don't have that information. Now that you're putting that information on there and showing their other work, because if this is a mural artist and let's say this painting's $5,000, then people are like, oh, wait a minute, they're getting $5,000 for this. How much is that big wall, you know? And it's making those connections.
Yeah, so you actually have a gallery attached to artists that have worked for sale through...
If they have a shop, you know, some have different shops, so that way you can look and say, okay, look, I can buy this print for $300 for this one. Or I can buy this, so that way, and people have sold, I've had a few artists say that I sold another one to Flint, someone in Flint, and it was kind of neat. So yeah, people have used it.
Nice. Yeah, that's a good way to use that for sure. I think that just one other question I kind of want to ask about Flint was because, like I said, Tampa, like we have three galleries pretty much here in the city. It might be, is it, how many? Is there three? There's like two or three.
Two and a half.
Yeah, I mean, so how is the scene in Flint? Like, I mean, obviously St. Pete, like, is banging. Yeah, I mean, you know, you have so many and the art scene's so connected, but here, it's really not, it hasn't been for a long time. How is it, you know, in Flint?
Yeah.
Like, how are you with it, in terms of gallery spaces outside of the technology that you're doing for the outdoor art, or is it just outdoor art and it's really, that's what's going on?
Well, in Flint, we were, one of the things that we were blessed with out of the automotive industry was the Flint Institute of Art, which has, for a small art museum, has an amazing, amazing, amazing collection. I mean, you can spend hours in this place looking at some really big names and some really good art, and it's like, wow, you know. We do have...
Do they show like regional and local artists within the Flint Institute, or is it more like institutional,
it's
like
more,
outside?
It's more like Detroit Institute of Art, all these other big, you know. So, but we do have another one that's called MW Gallery, which focuses on people of color. It does have some people of color from Flint, but also all over the world. And then we have Greater Flint Arts Council, which does shows, they have a different monthly show, and those are only Michigan artists, and so they have a student show, they have a university show, they have a street art show, all kinds of different ones, and then we have another gallery that shows a lot of local and also some other visiting.
Gotcha. Yeah, so you do sort of have that, what's kind of happening out on the streets with the artists that you're bringing through the street art, through the murals, happening within walls in maybe some institutionalized settings or some private galleries, which is super lacking here. So we have like these two worlds. So like, not to say we only have 2.5 galleries, but you know, we have HGC as well, which is, and there's USF CAM, which is actually more of a museum. So we have like these institutionalized like places to see art that are like in the academic world, but we don't really have a lot of those areas that bridge what's happening locally through our like cultural innovators, I would say. Like, you know, we have, and I'm sure it's like this with Flint too, but you have like these, the city art program, and you have like the arts council, and then you have sort of like cultural assets, government people. And then you have like this world that exists outside of the cultural aspects, studies, and those types of things. And one of the biggest things that I think is really important is like to merge those two, like those two worlds together, because that creates, you know, more opportunities, more paid opportunities for artists and those type of things.
Yes,
so
and
I don't know if
Flint is lacking that. Flint is lacking some of that. So the four galleries we have, are one museum and four galleries, or three galleries, what it's lacking, those are all planned out like a year in advance. Mm-hmm. And what Flint lacks is that, I don't know, impulse gallery that changes, you know, it's not this is this month or this is for six right. months, and then, you know, it needs something that this week it could be this week. This week it could be Polly, that week it could be Kevin, this week it could be three visiting artists, this week it could be that. It could, you know,
right.
it could change, and it's something happening, something fresh, something new over and over. We have an art walk that's very successful that does that every month, mm-hmm. but it needs to happen more. It needs a space for these local artists to be able to sell their work, show their work, market their work, along with other people coming in over and over and over.
Right, right, yeah. I feel like one of the biggest lacking things here on this side is obviously studio and gallery space. It
yeah,
just doesn't,
same with
doesn't
us.
Really exist a lot. I mean, and if you bring more studios, you're gonna get more gallery space.
Yeah.
It's just the way it works. So, you know, I don't know if you guys have like programs there. Like, that's what I was thinking about, the vacant buildings. Like, if you're doing these events in these vacant buildings, like, has that work? Because my idea is like, oh, that would work.
Well, it's outside. We do them outside of it. We don't really
yeah.
do them inside because of liability issues.
Right.
So it's outside of these event, you know, these areas. So getting some of these like pop up, but then you need to, when you get the galleries and all the stuff, you need the other infrastructure. So
yeah.
you need the stores.
Yeah.
You know, you need the coffee shop. There's all this, you know, it's
like walkable streets and things
right.
like that, so people can get around.
And so it's like, I mean, even, you know, the supplies have to be readily available.
Yeah.
You know, if you have to drive an hour and a half to go get...
Do you guys have, like, some good supply shops there?
We have Joanne Fabric Michaels.
No, yeah.
You know, so, I mean, without driving an hour away.
Get a shop up there.
Huh?
Get a Kroger shop in Flint.
Right.
Kill it.
So, yeah, that's my back room. No, I'm just kidding.
Like, seriously, like...
I know.
Before Blick, there wasn't much here. We had a Pearl, and
Blink's an hour away.
We had an AOE. AOE, I think, is closing down.
It's
gone. It's gone. Okay, so now Blink is like it. You know, which Blink is good because you can get everything, but you know, there really isn't. And then there's a there's some other shops got back in Tampa here, which is a good can shop, and we have Artist in St. Pete, which is another option.
And we have two really great universities in Flint.
Yeah.
So University of Michigan has a Flint location, which is a big campus that has a great art program.
Oh, cool.
We have Kettering University, which is an engineering university.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's like...
I mean, our institutions are really established as well, UT and the Scarlet Gallery, and then the HC Gallery. It's just that those worlds, like, do not blend into...
Right.
Is new contemporary.
Well,
like, at all. There's
we have my community college.
There's not a conversation around it.
My community college has a big art thing, so there's a need for art supplies.
Yeah.
An art supply place other than Joanne Fabrics
right.
or Michael's. You know, it's like you get those same, you can get the four same canvases at both places and the three pencils they have, you know.
Right, yeah. But, yeah. Well, if you build it, you know, they will come
so,
back and then, like, you know, someone does it. And it's just
right.
Like, but yeah, I think we've kind of covered all the bases.
All right.
If you have some, you know, if you have anything to add, or maybe like a.